And my mom, I remember this moment so clearly in my head. Dia bilang, pendidikan itu bukan cuma tergantung sekolahnya, tapi juga tergantung muridnya. I think banyak teman-teman sekarang mungkin bilang, I am not yet at the company that I really want to be in, or
Yes.
I'm not yet at the role. Kadang-kadang kalau aku dapat manajer yang kurang baik, juga aku menjadikan itu jadi pelajaran. Gitu. Balik lagi, when you have that student mindset, wherever you go, everywhere you go is a university. Everywhere you go is a school for you.
Welcome to Follow Your Flow Podcast. Kita membantu lifelong learner untuk berproses menuju life model yang lebih optimal dan sustainable. Di sini, kita akan belajar dari banyak sumber, mulai dari lifelong learner yang kita interview, sampai insight yang gue dan Mbak Ika dapat dari buku, artikel, podcast, maupun hasil refleksi pribadi kami. Di akhir setiap episode, lo akan mendapatkan science-backed, pragmatic step yang bisa membantu lo untuk mentransformasi hidup lo. Hope you enjoy this episode. Alright. So, welcome to Follow Your Flow Podcast. Jadi, guest gue hari ini adalah orang yang sudah gue follow di Instagram for quite some time. Karena dia itu suka sharing buku yang dia baca, reflection about her life and career, dan juga practical tips to thrive on those two aspects. Jadi, guest gue hari ini adalah Priscilla. So, Priscilla adalah seorang product management executive di Tokopedia. Dia ini lulusan Harvard Business School. Dan sebelumnya dia kerja di Kearney, sebuah top management consulting firm. Aside from that, seperti yang tadi gue udah share juga, dia tuh sering banget nge-share tentang knowledge-nya dia, tentang early career and personal development on Instagram. Jadi kalau misalnya lo belum follow Instagram-nya, then you should. Nanti gue akan kasih link-nya juga di podcast ini. Nah, dari konten yang gue lihat di publish sama Priscilla di her social media, I can feel her authenticity in sharing her knowledge to other people. Makanya gue pengen nih ngundang Priscilla di kesempatan kali ini untuk have like a deeper conversation about banyak hal yang Priscilla udah share sebelumnya, or maybe akan ada hal yang belum pernah dia share sebelumnya akan dia share di sesi kali ini. So, jadi interview ini akan dibagi jadi dua. Jadi di first part kita akan lebih mengenal tentang Priscilla, tentang journey-nya dia selama ini. And the second part lebih kayak kita akan kayak Q&A, like the top 5 questions yang sering banget masuk ke DM-nya Priscilla related to career and personal development. So, Pris, I'm super, super excited to chat with you today.
Thank you, Rio. Thank you for the invitation. Senang banget bisa di sini hari ini ya. To share my side of the story, mungkin kita bisa deep dive beberapa angle yang normally, you know, it's not as apparent kalau cuma baca my blog or my social media gitu ya. So, yay. Thanks again for the invitation and I'm excited to be here.
Yay, awesome, awesome. Mungkin kita mulai dari pertanyaan yang ringan dulu kali ya. Kayak... maybe we can start with, maybe you can share us a bit about yourself yang belum banyak orang tahu.
I think I consider myself as an introvert. Many people would not think of me as an introvert because they think, oh, you know, Priscilla does a lot of social media sharing. She often does a lot of public speaking engagement. But just because someone is out there and about, I think it's a huge assumption that people make that, you know, I'm very bubbly or always social in person. Actually, in my personal time, I spend a lot of time in solitude by myself, whether reading a book or journaling or writing. You know, I do a lot of mentoring work. Even today, if you compare the number of hours that I spend on mentoring on one-on-one versus mentoring, you know, in a group setting or doing webinar, actually more hours are spent doing the more private sessions. I think it's a big one that people don't realize that I personally recharge by being alone.
Oh, interesting. Karena banyak orang make assumption ketika misalnya orang tuh suka share something publicly, it means that person is extrovert, tapi lo lebih identify yourself as an introvert. Interesting.
And maybe to add to that, many people at my work would also think the same gitu because they see me, you know, I would manage a meeting very confidently or I don't mind speaking up. But for me, it's not about being an extrovert versus introvert, but being a great communicator is part of the job. You know, when you're a senior leader at a big company, it is part of the job to be able to communicate clearly and in a way that, you know, is able to align people, bring people together, engage people, get people excited. I think that's my job. Whereas my blogging and my sharing, a lot of my sharing is driven by the want to really help people. So it's not because I'm looking for some kind of fame or publicity, or I'm fully comfortable with sharing, even sometimes before I hit post on some of, you know, my more vulnerable or personal sharing, I really think about it. And not everything is comfortable, but I feel like, hey, sometimes, you know, when I'm down, or, you know, you don't always share all of these super positive quotes. I felt like, okay, I think about it, and someone out there really needs to hear this message so that they don't feel like they're alone. And then I hit posts, you know, that's really what motivates me to do more public sharing versus my natural personality.
Wow. Even dari apa yang lo share barusan, I think I can learn one thing yang can be useful for a lot of people, right? Karena I think personality is one thing, right? You identify yourself as introvert, tapi when it comes to either do your job or to do something that matters for you, you are willing to adjust that, right? In the way yang sebenarnya masih work for you. So, wow, I think that's a great lesson, karena I think masih banyak orang, termasuk gue juga kadang-kadang, we get trapped bahwa, oh ya, gue kan introvert, so I'll just keep everything to myself and I don't really talk to other people, right? But what I really like from you and your example adalah you don't let that to become an obstacle for you to be effective in doing your job and to do what matters.
Yeah,
What else, Pris? Yang kayak kira-kira orang mungkin, maybe it's people don't know about you or people often misunderstand about you.
I think another one where, you know, I'm so glad for this special opportunity to talk more about me. This quoting a lot of Priscilla's quotes, right? Which is a lot of the output. Like, that's the output of my own personal journey and my own reflections, right? The second thing that many people don't know about me is that I didn't grow up with the happiest childhood or with the most comfortable situation. Growing up, I certainly had times when my family was successful and we had some money and we were very comfortable. We also definitely dealt with some periods of family bankruptcy. So I've had moments when, you know, I didn't even know whether my mom could pay for my school tuition. I've had moments when we had to borrow money or run out of electricity, and again, borrow money from our friends or family for me to keep paying for electricity or for school. Because many people, you know, when they see me, or at least whatever my Instagram and whatnot says, they always assume, wow, you know, this person is so successful. She must have had all the facility, all the privileges. You know, she went to Harvard Business School and everything must have been easy for her, and I can't have what she has today. She must have had something very special in her. What many people don't realize is that actually I grew up with a lot of obstacles and challenges too, and frankly, not a lot of money. You know, I had to rely on scholarship both to finish my college as well as to pursue my MBA degree. I had to manage my own personal finances. When I first graduated from my college, I did not have savings. In fact, when I graduated from MBA, I also wiped out my savings for all the MBA and all the travels. So yeah, that I think that kind of uncomfortable situation justru yang jadi guru dalam hidup. And I hope that by today's sharing, it motivates many people who are not in the best of circumstances to be able to see, like, hey, actually, if Priscilla can make it, maybe I can make it too, gitu. I hope that's something that people can take away from our conversation today.
Wow. I think that's very powerful, and thanks for sharing the not so smooth part of your life, gitu kan. Yang sebenarnya juga gue baru tahu recently, when we prep for this, right, when you shared that. Dan menurut gue, I think sometimes we are too easy to judge people. To say misalnya ngeliat profilnya Priscilla, right? Kayak it's like, ah, it's like super privileged, everything is set up. Tapi by hearing this, sebenarnya nggak kok. I think there is like a lot of struggle that happened in your past that makes you who you are today.
Yeah, I think many people, they're, you know, it's so easy to tell my story in two ways. Like, wow, she went to school abroad, and then she went into management consulting, and then she got into a very prestigious MBA degree, and then from there she went on to Tokopedia, and then she, you know, gained a lot of really good experience. That's one way to tell the story. But if you're a skeptic and you're only looking at the challenges, right, you can also say that, hey, Priscilla was actually orphaned when she was really young, or she did not have enough money growing up, or there was a lot of financial and family instability that happened in her life. Jadi, why am I telling this? Karena banyak orang yang, when they look around gitu kan, oh, aku keluarga aku nggak punya uang. Atau, oh, aku banyak sekali tantangan di hidup saya gitu kan. Oh, aku kurang pintar gitu kan di sekolah. And you let the excuses or your external circumstances define your future. Which kalau aku mau ngomong circumstances, like my I went through everything, so many things in my life. You know, we've been, you know, our house was burned down. We've gone through bankruptcy. Kita pernah dirampok. Kita pernah utang. Pernah semuanya gitu ya. Jadi whatever you think, you know, bad happen in your life, I think I can come up with some kind of measure. But it takes, you know, I want people to know that don't let these circumstances define you or define what you can and cannot do in your life. Mungkin timingnya, I will be honest, timingnya akan berbeda ya buat setiap orang. Tentunya you're gonna take a longer route. I did not get to Harvard for my undergraduate college, right? I had to take a detour and get the appropriate learnings and experience to qualify for such a school. But eventually you get there, and I think that's the message that I want to get out from this conversation today. Whatever, wherever you are today, it's not about where you are today, it's about where you're going, gitu. Jadi ingat, wherever you are, you can always create a path to get to where you want to be.
Wow, that's really, really, really powerful. I think I just want to call it out one more time, right? Karena kayak what you said adalah, maybe it, again, right now we don't get what we want, kita belum dapat itu semua. Right, but there is a path, and we can create our own path to get us closer to that. Maybe in some circumstances tetap nggak dapat juga, right? But we actually have more power than we think to bring us closer to that. And you are one of the living example of it. So thanks, Pris, for sharing that.
Amin. Glad to be able to share my story today.
Awesome. Awesome. Nah, maybe just one thing to double click on your previous experience, right? Maksudnya kayak ketika early days, ketika hidup tuh nggak segampang itu, right? The question adalah, was there any pivotal moments, either misalnya kayak certain adversities yang bikin lo percaya bahwa, yes, my future actually can be better. Because at that time, itu ada fenomena di psychology yang namanya downward spiral, di mana biasanya kalau kita udah jatuh, bukannya tambah turun, tapi jatuh lagi, right? But typically, there are like moments. Ini bisa jadi kayak sebuah momen yang gede banget. Or even like some words from some people yang bisa pelan-pelan ngubah kita and we go up. Do you have such moments at the time?
Mungkin I'll share, I don't have a pivotal moment like that, but I'll share a moment yang menanamkan mindset aku sangat dalam gitu loh. To be grateful and to just work with the cards that I'm dealt with in life. Jadi pas aku SMP gitu kan, pas aku SMP, my mom, you know, she was still a single mom, she was still recovering from our family bankruptcy. She knew that I was a great student gitu loh. Nilai aku bagus dan dari aku masuk ke SMP waktu itu Bina Bangsa School di Kebun Jeruk. Tapi sebenarnya that was not our plan as a family. I wanted to go to a better school and even something that have even better program. More school support gitu loh, bahkan mungkin international school. Dan aku bilang ke ibuku, "Ma, kayaknya nih nilaiku udah bagus gitu loh, Ma. Kayaknya udah waktunya aku pindah ke sekolah yang lebih baik gitu kan. Like I deserve it. Please give me, allow me to, you know, send me to a better school gitu kan." And my mom, I remember this moment so clearly in my head. We were driving, kita lagi ngelewatin pasar Fatmawati. Dan dia bilang gitu loh, "Neng," she calls me Neng Gelis. Neng, dia bilang, "Neng, kadang pendidikan itu bukan cuma tergantung sekolahnya, tapi juga tergantung muridnya." Gitu. She just left me at that. I know, I think now that I've grown up, looking back, what I asked was very childish. You know, I think we did not have the money to afford to a better school, and I was very selfish gitu kan, cuma ngeliat dari perspektif aku. Tapi dari what my mom told me gitu kan, pendidikan itu bukan cuma sekolahnya. It's not always about being at the best school with the best facilities. It's also about who you are as a student. Dan itu sangat formative banget ya, what my mom shared. Because from then onward, I still did not, I think all throughout dari SMP, SMA, I did not go to the top or the most famous schools di Indonesia atau di luar negeri gitu. But I made the best out of the education that I got. Whatever class that I did, ya udah dimaksimalkan aja gitu loh. Dan bahkan di luar sekolah pun, di luar kurikulum sekolah, aku terus haus gitu ya, menggali pengetahuan. That's what led me to my love for books, for to satiate the hunger for intellectual knowledge that my school maybe was not giving to me gitu. And I realized my mom was right. Sometimes it's about the student. I know so many people yang udah punya segala macam fasilitas, udah ditaruh di sekolah terbaik. Many people don't have that hunger for learning. On vice versa, I see many people yang nggak tahu lah sekolahnya di mana lah. Kadang-kadang listrik nggak ada, tapi bisa jadi olimpiade matematika gitu kan. Kayak, you know, these moments of marvels really make you think gitu kan. Is it about circumstance or is it about, you know, your own character and your own drive? I think what my mom said, it's about the student. It really reminds me, ya udah jangan lihat kiri kanan gitu kan. Even sometimes itu kan waktu sekolah ya. Even where you are working, I think banyak teman-teman sekarang mungkin bilang, I am not yet at the company that I really want to be in, or
Yes.
I'm not yet at the role. I don't have the perfect manager. I don't have the perfect mentor. Well, maybe it's not about having the perfect mentor or about being in the perfect company. It's about whether you have the student mindset, the growth mindset to learn and make the most out of your current situation. Gitu. Karena there are moments in my career where I learn, aku bukan cuma mengambil belajar dari contoh terbaik. Kadang-kadang kalau aku dapat manajer yang kurang baik, juga aku menjadikan itu jadi pelajaran. Gitu. Balik lagi, when you have that student mindset, wherever you go, everywhere you go is a university. Everywhere you go is a school for you.
Wow, that is actually very very powerful, Pris. Maksud gue kayak I think you know the wisdom that you share from your mom, right? Kayak sometimes it's not only about the school, but it's about the student. Itu menurut gue mengajarkan self-efficacy to the next level, right? Karena we do not really depend on our environment. Karena mungkin kadang-kadang our environment is against us, tapi if we show the attitude, if we have the mindset, gitu kan, we can actually make it. And maybe mungkin sekarang belum bisa, tapi we'll figure it out. And I think that's very, very powerful sih. Dan tadi, actually, you did very well juga ketika lo bilang bahwa yes, ini very applicable for people yang mungkin lagi tidak berada di situasi ideal, kan. Mau misalnya nggak berada di level yang mereka pengenin, atau di pekerjaan yang mereka pengenin. I think this mindset is like applicable for that. And thanks for sharing that with us. Nah, sekarang gue mau shift gear nih, kayak abis lo lulus kuliah gitu kan, then you started your career as a management consultant di Kearney, right? So, maybe you can tell us a bit, you know, what made you start your career as a management consultant?
Thank you banget ya Rio for asking that question. Karena sekarang kan gue banyak ngajarin orang gitu ya, oh ya how to navigate your career gitu.
Yes.
Tapi gue sendiri, admittedly, when I navigated my career, I was very shallow. Situasinya adalah ketika aku kuliah, that's when my mother passed away. Jadi my personal financial circumstance really changed. Tadinya kan I relied on my mother for money, but from then onwards I had no source of income whatsoever. My original plan sebenarnya pas ke university was to learn to be a professor. I really wanted to be a professor either in political science, atau di anthropology, or even sociology. Cuman kan namanya profesor ya, I was not gonna make money for a long time, butuh uang pula buat PhD, and being an international student, I may not qualify for many, many scholarships gitu. Nah, jadi karena that very hard reality ya, huge slap in the face, I had to, you know, banting setir. Aku ingat banget lagi study abroad di Oxford, banting setir, and look into jobs like management consulting dan investment banking, yang menjanjikan gaji yang lumayan besar. Jadi the number one consideration waktu itu lebih karena financial, and I knew that kalau aku ke management consulting atau investment banking, they could give me very good salary and I could save money, and then mungkin abis 2-3 tahun kerja, waktu itu rencananya aku bakal go back to my PhD gitu. So that was the impetus why I wanted to be a management consultant. And at the same time, I also do love the intellectual rigor yang ditawarkan oleh management consulting ya, looking into different problems, looking at different industries. I almost think like, wah ini udah kayak kelas juga ya, karena kan ngelihat industri banyak sekali, berbeda dengan berbagai macam analytical framework, kayaknya bakal tetap seru. And it's true, ujung-ujungnya pas udah masuk ke kerjaan management consulting, benar-benar seru sih, gitu loh. So I'm glad that worked out. What I did not expect is, I love helping the private sector so much that I decided to let go of my dream of being a professor. Turns out, aku lebih suka ya bikin short-term impact lewat berkontribusi di private sector. Contohnya lewat management consulting, atau bahkan sekarang kan aku menjadi bagian dari sebuah perusahaan di Indonesia. Gitu.
Got it, got it, got it. Wow, thanks for being very open about your decision at that time ya. And this helped me reflect gitu. Karena dulu tuh gue dengan sangat gampang misalnya kayak judge people, ih kerja cuma buat cari uang doang, right? But I think every person has different circumstances, right? Dan maksudnya di situasi yang kayak lo hadapi, it's actually a very logical reason to prioritize that. Karena that's the prerequisite to survive, right? So thanks for sharing that. Karena itu memberikan color on why people work, why people make certain decision, or kenapa faktor-faktor tertentu tuh diprioritaskan, right? I think a lot of people, dan mungkin gue beruntung juga ketika gue mengambil keputusan karir gue yang pertama, I didn't have that situation, jadi it's not only about money, but now perspektif lo tuh memberikan gue gambaran yang lebih luas. Karena mungkin kalau gue berada di posisi lo atau people in general in the, you know, like very very limited financial resources at that time, ya yeah, would pick for the same reason. Then the follow up question to that adalah ketika lo udah kerja nih di management consulting, right? Then after that you went to MBA. So what made you decided to go for an MBA, Pris?
Kembali lagi, alasannya masih sangat shallow.
Yeah.
Jadi waktu itu ada two big reasons why I decided to pursue an MBA. Pertama, karena aku udah menemukan waktu itu calling lah untuk terus menjadi consulting. Going into an MBA is a very common, it's a very common path buat banyak consultant gitu. Rata-rata kalau di consulting itu, you are almost encouraged to take an MBA to further strengthen your business and marketing fundamentals. Jadi itu satu. Dan part of that, enaknya itu kalau di consulting sebenarnya, biasanya kan kalau orang master gitu, kayak you lose 2 years of career lah, kasarnya gitu. Jadi kalau di consulting gitu kan, banyak orang di tahun ketiga atau keempatnya mereka, mereka pursue an MBA, mereka pas balik itu nggak kehilangan quote and quote promosinya gitu loh Rio. Pas mereka kembali, they go back as an associate itu which is a fifth year position. So you almost have this special time in your career as a consultant di mana you don't lose your promotion. You know, I think satu karena itu, kedua karena my boyfriend at the time and who is now my husband waktu itu udah MBA duluan. Jadi untuk supaya kita LDR-nya tidak terlalu lama, I thought it would be really nice for us to go do an MBA at the same time. Jadi pengen banget nih MBA bukan cuman karena career consideration and how it was gonna strengthen my foundation as a consultant, tapi juga buat personal circumstance-nya, udah ada pacar yang udah lagi MBA juga di US, jadi kita pengen ngejar waktu dan bisa di US bareng-bareng.
Oke. Wow, that's interesting karena menurut gue even your decision juga kayak adds another color gitu kan tentang kenapa orang decided to go for an MBA, right? That makes a lot of sense. Dan yang menarik di sini adalah kan while a lot of people makes decision based on passion or based on what I like gitu, tapi dari tadi gue tidak melihat itu adalah konsiderasi yang kayak lo sebut-sebut gitu. How do you factor that ketika lo memilih karir? Apakah you don't put that? Kayak, how do you put passion or your interest inside, you know, career decision?
Well, actually, throughout, mungkin pas aku masuk ke Kearney, decision-nya nggak di situ ya, karena it was a lot of it had to do with the financial circumstance. And it just so happens that I had, you know, certain internships and background yang bikin aku stumble gitu kan, buat menjadi consultant. Tetapi pas MBA, itu adalah sebuah decision yang berdasarkan passion gitu, karena pas aku daftar MBA, I love being consulting and MBA is something yang highly highly complementary terhadap consulting. Even until today, you know, I think 30% of MBA graduates they still go back to consulting gitu. Nah, mungkin yang aku mau highlight untuk teman-teman pendengar hari ini adalah job market hari ini sangat berbeda dengan job market ketika aku graduate. Ketika aku graduate, many people, you know, the best jobs you could get, you know, the coolest jobs you could get was like in consulting or banking or, you know, you're joining like major FMCG or major brands or major banks or being an MD. Back then, pas aku lulus di tahun 2014, Tokopedia belum segede sekarang. Gojek wasn't even an app at the time gitu.
Benar juga, ya.
Nah, sekarang kita ada di tahun 2021, di mana when if you're graduating from school today, the choices of jobs available to you today are so diverse, so interesting, so specific gitu. Sekarang graduate sekarang bisa berimajinasi, bisa bermimpi, oh mungkin aku mau jadi engineer, mungkin aku mau jadi ke marketing gitu kan, mungkin aku mau jadi category leaders, mungkin aku mau jadi product manager. menurut aku job market sekarang tuh jauh lebih beragam, jauh lebih menarik, lebih technical juga by the way, lebih technical karena when marketing expert today itu jauh berbeda dengan marketing expert 8 tahun lalu. Nah, tapi yang my point now is that frankly speaking, master's degree today is worth less and less compared to master's degree, you know, berapa tahun lalu. Sekarang, if you ask me as a senior leader untuk pilih seseorang yang udah punya job experience 2 tahun dibanding orang yang udah punya master, I would always choose the person with the real job experience. Mungkin ini yang, again, membedakan master's decision making hari ini kali ya, Rio. The premium on real life experience sekarang itu jauh lebih tinggi gitu, Rio. When you're working in a startup today, you are getting, you know, project management, you are getting leadership skills, you are getting communication skills that someone who has worked for 3 years in a company today, wah, they are already like basically a junior manager. Depending when I graduated, for you to earn a leadership skill, you probably need to be in a, you know, fourth or fifth year position at least for you to even be managing projects. Today, the fresh grads that work in my team already manage their own projects. So we're at a very different landscape, di mana the skills or the knowledge that can be offered in master, it is really less and less compared to the skills and knowledge that can be offered from a real life job experience gitu.
Wow. Just wanna highlight menurut gue poin yang tadi very very important. Karena sebenarnya sadar nggak sadar, biarpun cuma beberapa tahun, tapi job market beberapa tahun terakhir tuh perlu swingnya kencang banget ya. So I graduated in 2014 from an engineering school, dan waktu itu kayak the number one job adalah oil and gas. Kayak teknik perminyakan itu kayak teknik paling populer, right? Everybody wants to go there gitu kan. Tapi iya kan, kayak nggak ada yang ngomongin tentang tech company at that time. Kayak either, you know, oil and gas, FMCG, or consulting, right? Kayak pilihannya industri itu lagi. Tapi like you said gitu, bahwa even nggak nyampe 10 tahun, itu udah agak-agak terbalik gitu equation-nya. Sekarang kayak banyak banget opportunity di tech companies yang even like 5 years ago nggak kebayang ada ya.
Aku juga, by the way aja, aku nggak tahu banyak orang yang daftar ke consulting sekarang. Semua orang daftarnya tuh ke startup-startup gitu kan, antara startup kecil, startup gede, but I rarely hear people applying ke consulting nowadays because I guess like what you originally said, right? You know, do people, you know, how to make career based on your passion. Nowadays, people are more attuned to their own passion and their own calling. Yeah. Mungkin financial is still important, but it's not the number one driving factor. And people really want to live a life yang they find meaningful gitu kan. Again, I think, you know, if you're graduating this year, you're living at an excellent time karena ya the job market jauh lebih beragam, ya jauh lebih menarik, jauh lebih seru. You can really pursue whatever you want to do gitu. You want to be a social media manager, you want to be a content creator, you can do it today and you can make money from it today. Mungkin 2013 nggak ada kali ya, Rio, ya. Pekerjaan kayak gitu ya, jadi content creator and whatnot.
Benar banget, benar banget. So, before we dive further gitu ya to your decision on joining Tokopedia mungkin sekitar 3 years ago, ya mungkin tadi mungkin kalau gue tangkep partly lo menjelaskan gitu, but before that gue pengen agak balik ke your MBA time gitu kan. So, a lot of people took MBA karena mereka pengen belajar management, right? Tapi kan in your case you have done management consulting before. Nah, mungkin lo bisa share about apa sih kayak maybe one or two lessons yang lo pelajari ketika lo lagi di MBA. It can be what you learn from the class or from your peers or maybe not related to that.
Ya, tentunya namanya business school banyak banget ya foundational knowledge di finance, di marketing, di analysis yang aku pupuk gitu. But I think that's pretty straightforward. Mungkin I'll share one or two lessons that really changed my life that I got from either interacting with people or experiencing things selama MBA itu. Satu hal yang paling berkesan selama MBA itu, between my first year and second year MBA itu, aku sama beberapa teman sekelas, kita berlibur ke Jamaica. Liburannya ini bukan cuma liburan biasa-biasa saja. It was a 1 week long trip of yoga and meditation. Dimana kita, ya, tripnya juga nggak terlalu mahal, kita tinggal di tempat yang hampir kayak gubuk, nggak ada AC, makannya semuanya vegan, every day, mostly beans and bananas. Ketika bangun, kita meditasi, habis itu yoga, and then the rest of the day, we just spend time with nature. Dan malamnya juga balik lagi ditutup dengan yoga dan meditation sebelum tidur. And we had, you know, I think it was me and my 10 classmates for 1 week. Dan pakai bajunya semuanya tiap hari cuma baju yoga aja gitu ya, nggak ada baju yang keren-keren, nggak ada yang punya barang mewah, makanan nggak mewah. Dan somehow that 1 week being away from a lot of what we know as life gitu kan, away from social media, away from internet, it made me realize how rich life really is gitu. Karena sebelum aku MBA, Rio, jujur aja, I define like 80 or 90% of my identity through my job. Kalau aku dipromosi, aku sangat bahagia gitu. All I know in my life was that, okay, by the time I'm 40, I'm gonna be CEO of a large company. That's all I care about. That's what drove me gitu kan, into the MBA. Tapi from that experience, I realized, actually hidup itu bukan cuma kerjaan. Dan setiap kita itu bukan cuma memiliki identitas sebagai profesional gitu kan. Mungkin aku sekarang di Tokopedia adalah seorang product manager, seorang product leader gitu. But that's now, I don't let that define me anymore. I'm also a sister. I'm also a wife. I'm also a friend to many people. I'm also a mentor to many people, gitu loh. Jadi aku jadi realize bisa take a step back and see the big picture of my life. And I realize then I care much more about my own values and pursuing my own meaning and my own definition of success daripada definisi sukses yang sering kali diimpos oleh masyarakat atau popular media gitu ya.
Wow, that's amazing. Maksud gue kayak now you played back about your the lesson yang lo pelajari, almost itu benar-benar life changing banget gak sih, Pris? Maksud gue kayak dari yang sebelumnya lo memikirkan, you know, life is all about career, sampai akhirnya you come up that you are actually Priscilla and you have many identities di luar karir, right? Kayak tadi, as a wife, as a friend, as a mentor, right? Even like as a book reader, right? Itu tuh, it's so like a lesson yang menarik, karena I think, I don't know if this is like apple to apple, right? Tapi gue pernah baca sebuah newsletter, and the newsletter itu tuh sebenarnya ngebahas tentang sebenarnya this is the concept of diversifying our identity. Karena kan kalau dia ngomongin personal finance, a lot of people say bahwa don't put all your eggs in one basket, right? Karena ya kalau that investment gak jalan, you still have other source of income atau other kayak investment. And I think what you just did, what you did at that time adalah investment of identity. Jadi kayak you don't put your identity only in one basket, tapi kayak ada beberapa identity, right? And I personally felt that's more resilient. So in case you screw up in one thing, you can still hang on to other identities yang lain. Karena I think the trap for people, especially gue relate banget ketika misalnya early days when I screw up on my career, kayak it's very tempting to think that I am a failure or I am like a failed person. Padahal sebenarnya maybe I'm a failed consultant or maybe I'm a failed employee or I'm not doing well as an employee. Tapi on the other facet masih lumayan doing well. Right? I think I really like your approach.
Well, actually, just compound it with one more lesson yang sering banget diajarin gitu ya di classroom-nya Harvard Business School. Di Harvard Business School itu kan diajarkan dengan case method, di mana kita melihat kasus studi kasus dari perusahaan yang berbeda, CEO maupun leader-leader yang berbeda. Dan one underlying message from the school that they're trying to teach you adalah there are many different ways of success. If you think success is a lot of money, yeah, sure, that's your definition, and you can be. There are ways for you to make a company profitable, but bullying your own employees. There are ways to achieve a profitable company juga, gitu loh, by doing things mungkin slower, maybe not as much money as you could be making, but it's you can do things in a way that is much kinder to your employees. Dan Harvard Business School tidak bilang satu leader atau satu style lebih baik daripada yang lain. It's up to you. It's your choice. Kita nggak bilang, oh cuman perusahaan yang culture-nya sangat baik gitu ya, sangat lovey-dovey dengan employee-nya itu perusahaan yang baik. No, they never said that. They're saying that there are different definitions of success. You as a person should just know yours. Jadi I think kalau dikombinasi dengan, you know, my experience, you know, rediscovering the richness of life dengan that key message of Harvard business school that there are many different definitions of success, it gives me the confidence to pursue or define my own definition of success. Tadinya, going into the school masih muda, masih mungkin naif, masih insecure banget, gitu kan Rio. I follow whatever popular media teaches, right? Success adalah kekayaan. Success adalah fame, you know, when people, you know, respect you. I think I really followed that. But after that whole school, when I graduated, success is about being authentic to me. Success is about being authentic to myself and still, you know, be allow, pursue my passion, bisa berkarya, bisa berbagi while living a happy and meaningful life. Gitu. Banyak orang menurut aku kayak sekarang are still so focused or obsessed about their work. But they forget that actually their family life or their personal life is equally important gitu loh. They spend many, many hours at work trying to get this promotion or this recognition or that recognition. Tapi di rumahnya sendirinya mentally berantakan, you know, they're unhappy. They are not able to appreciate their own success or their own journey. Mereka juga tidak menghargai the love that they get from their friends or from their family. Malah jadi gagal di situ, Rio. I mean, countless research have told us what makes human happy and meaningful is relationship gitu. Jadi mari kita berkaca dengan bejibun research itu gitu ya, teman-teman, jangan lupa it's okay to pursue your passion and of course aspire to the greatest heights of your career. I'm not discouraging that, tapi jangan lupa sumber kebahagiaan, sumber arti dalam hidup itu is a relationships. A relationship. Then actually the most important relationship of all is not just relationship with our friends and family, but also relationships with ourselves. So I think definitely put an importance to my own self-care, my own mental well-being, right after I graduated from the school series.
Got it. Wow. That's very powerful, sih, that you get that lesson and you get the chance to share that in this episode juga, Chris. Tadi, you know, when you say about relationship and stuff, itu kayak it really hits me juga gitu. Karena I think early in my career, I didn't put that as a priority. Terus kayak one book that me realized, gue gak tahu lo sempat ketemu orangnya apa enggak. It's How Will You Measure Your Life. I think it's the work of Professor Clay Christensen, right? I don't know, did you meet him?
Yes, I met him. Wow. I did not take his class, but I think he would like give a seminar here and there.
It's
a great book. It's definitely a great book for you.
Exactly. Karena kan kayak diingetin gitu kan, kayak there are other facets of life yang dimana unless we start investing in them now, they will be gone. Things like health, like family, right? Karena it's not that we think that, okay, today let's just work hard, dan nanti kayak 15 years down the line, I'll pay attention to my family. Padahal kan relationship is being nurtured, right?
Yeah, you can't. You know, in relationship, you gotta show up every day. You know, you can't make someone feel love just by, oh ya, nanti pas kita liburan keluarga aja gitu kan di Bali, di bulan Juni, that's when I'll be nice, that's when I'll pay attention to the family. Even if you're fully present in the job, you miss out on that person's important moments gitu loh, throughout their lives. Moments when you should be there next to them gitu. I think relationship's really important and you have to prioritize it sih. Karena dunia sekarang makin hari, it's so distracting. Your job in itself is a huge distraction already. Tambah lagi, belum lagi berbagai macam form of entertainment ya, Netflix lah, YouTube lah, they really suck you away, you know, they suck the energy away, they suck your attention away from things that really matter, you know, then the amount of conversation and care you can show someone gitu kan, kita fokus dan kita harus benar-benar mau gitu ya Rio membangun itu.
Totally agree. And based on the lesson that you got from HBS and all like the credibilities juga gitu kan, I was sure that you had so many options after lo lulus dari HBS. So, what was the thought process behind akhirnya you chose Tokopedia?
Jadi sebenarnya tadi kan aku udah cerita sedikit ya, how pas masuk consulting malah jadi jatuh cinta gitu sama consulting. Sebenarnya pas aku masuk MBA, my plan when I graduate is to go back to consulting. I love consulting so much. I think I was a great consultant, comfort zone banget. Dan aku suka in a service industry. Service industry itu ya kayak gitulah, project basis gitu loh. You're not part of the industry full time gitu kan.
Yeah.
Di consulting sendiri kan hidupnya project per project ya, Rio. Kalau lagi ngikutin project santai, kalau lagi project kliennya ganti-ganti, timnya pun ganti-ganti gitu loh. Jadi kalau lagi in between project ya cuti aja gitu loh. nggak tahu deh itu perusahaannya benar-benar baik atau enggak gitu ya. Like, because you have in a way limited responsibility in your life. I really enjoyed that part. Cuman then long story short, pas lagi MBA, kebetulan kakak kelasku dua-duanya kerja, you know, they decided to join Tokopedia, dan Pak William lagi visiting Boston gitu. Kita jadi
Wow.
ngobrol, gue ditawarin makan gratis, ya siapa juga, you know, makan student with free food. I was not gonna turn down free food. Waktu itu nggak ada agenda gimana-gimana ya, karena gue cuma mikir, oh ya ini figurnya luar biasa sekali gitu, dan saya juga
Yeah.
di mau traktir gitu, jadi how can I say no to that? Udah makan, of course Pak William at the end of the dinner kayak dia bilang, oh Priscilla nanti kalau mau join Tokopedia bilang saya aja gitu kan, you know I would love for you to join. Tapi I think the first time he said that to me, aku kayak ngerasa ah ini mah cuman ngomong baik aja gitu kan.
Ya.
Nah, it's just polite gesture for him to say that, but he's not serious. Nah, ternyata mereka serius. Di Tokopedia they said that they're looking for a team to join them gitu kan. Really as family, they shared more about the culture di Tokopedia, the 3DNA, growth mindset, make it happen, make it better, and also, you know, focus on customer. I think aku sebenarnya nggak pengen-pengen banget waktu itu ke Tokopedia because satu, my fiance waktu itu udah kerja di Singapura, which means aku tambah long distance lagi, bakal long distance 5 tahun. Bayangin kalau aku kerja di Tokopedia kan. It was a huge decision. Another one was that startup back then is still a huge gamble gitu kan. I don't know whether I'm gonna fit into the culture gitu. I was trained as a consultant in a very structured environment. Kita juga orangnya tuh mirip gitu kan. Sedangkan kalau di startup itu, there's so many different kind of roles, different kind of personalities, different kind of jobs, that I wasn't sure whether I'm gonna fit into that gitu kan. Learning curve-nya itu bakal sangat steep. Nah, jadi what really drove me to take the Tokopedia job was my own best friend's advice. Dia bilang, Chris, go where it scares you, because that's where you will learn the most. He's still my best friend till today. Then I think the thought of joining Tokopedia freaked me out, right? Back then Tokopedia jauh lebih kecil daripada Tokopedia sekarang. Lebih tetap masih risky waktu itu. It was 2018. We were a 2,000 people company gitu kan. But I realized it was scary. I also realized that this opportunity will never come again. Gitu loh. I think namanya juga startup ya, itu bakal pertumbuhannya cepat. Sedangkan kalau consulting, the door will always be open. It's a job that has been around since 100 years ago. I think the job of consulting will continue to be around another 100 years from now if AI does not take over. But I think it'll still be there. Jadi, yeah, I took that chance to join Tokopedia. And it so far, it really worked out great. It's scary at first, but I really learned a lot. I grew as a person. Jadi, to simplify, I think satu aku cari learning-nya. It was also a very unique opportunity. Dan yang ketiga, I saw a strong cultural fit. You know, I was very drawn to Tokopedia's culture. Aku juga itu pas checking around, I've never heard anybody say anything bad about Tokopedia's culture. Jadi, impressive banget ya bisa culture-nya Tokopedia itu bisa sampai ke bawah gitu loh. Like people who really live by the company DNA. Gak cuma slogan-slogan marketing gitu kan yang ditaruh sama HR
awesome.
Di banyak poster.
Awesome. I think the advice from your friend itu ngeri-ngeri sedap ya. The things that scares you off.
Dan untuk nambahin, a year into my job di Tokopedia, aku dikasih kesempatan. Tokopedia was going through a slight reorg, di mana tadinya Tokopedia itu ada business, product, tech, so they were ada tiga pohon besar lah gitu loh. Tapi they decided to combine business dan product, di merge gitu. And so I was from the business tree. And I had the choice to follow my old boss into business gitu kan, ke kategori leadership di Tokopedia. Atau ditanya, Epis, you know, you seem to have a passion or a curiosity towards product. Would you like to join the product organization? Nah, itu juga, that was another big moment in my career di Tokopedia, di mana I could have followed my old boss. You know, I was, you know, have a great relationship with her. I was so good in business. It's my comfort zone. Atau I could, again, start from zero. Be a student, product dari yang gue gak tahu apa-apa, belajar lagi gitu loh. Start managing from a smaller scope. I knew when I called my best friend, he's gonna have the same advice. Dia bilang, go where it scares you, go where it's hard, because that's where you learn the most. And I'm so glad that I still took that advice again with my career, karena by joining product, becoming a product leader, walaupun there was a huge learning curve ya, that I had to pay for that transition, I think being a product person has opened my horizon as a leader gitu. When I see a problem, I no longer just see the business problem or the marketing problem, but I can also approach a problem from the product angle, you know, and being even more user-centric than before. You know, businesses are often not very user-centric in the sense that business bilangnya cuma, oh, ini unit economics-nya seperti ini, oh, taruh aja uang marketing, nanti kira-kira sales growth-nya begini. But in reality, product is not like that. You know, the little details in a product matters, whether it could be about the design, about the UX, about the function that you're offering, what is your value proposition. It really makes you think in a more user-centric manner and question about the value, you know, what is the true value that you bring to your customer in your product. Jadi, having that other dimension of analysis and insight has really enriched me as a professional.
Got it. And I'm intrigued to ask you like a follow-up advice, right? Like the first advice is to go where it scares you. Then, you know, when people get that advice, mungkin ada orang yang masih kayak on the fence bahwa, yeah, I know, but it's very scary, right? So what would be your follow-up advice as someone who have taken the leap into like the things that scared you?
I don't want to give that advice, like go where it scares you to everybody, because I want to be respectful that people have different values. You know, not everyone should have the stamina to learn or start from scratch. For example, if you have a family to feed and you are more focused on getting promoted, you know, into the next role and make more money so that your family can be more comfortable, maybe that's what you should be prioritizing. Gitu. I also nggak mau kayak go where it scares you all the time gitu ya, and you keep changing jobs and keep learning something new. Gitu. But mungkin a related advice for career that I can give is that semuanya ada musimnya. There is a season for everything. I want people to remember that. Kayak my teammates, they come to me and they ask, Chris, sometimes, you know, I just got promoted, but I don't feel as ambitious right now. Is it okay for me to slow down? And sometimes they feel guilty, you know, to slow down in a startup. And I'm like, no, don't feel guilty. You know, you're about to become a mom. Your body is going through a lot. This is maybe the season for you to slow down. If you're planning a wedding and you're really busy, maybe it's the season for you to slow down. You know, you're a father and you just have your first child and you want to spend more time at home. Maybe that's the season for you to slow down. But likewise, right, there are seasons for you to take risk. It seems like the perfect time. A project calls out to you. You have good chemistry with the founders or with the friends who you're about to co-found a company with. Like seize that moment gitu. Karena itu ada musimnya nyantai gitu ya, just go with the flow. Ada musimnya you take a bit more risk with your career gitu. So it's okay. There are these different seasons. Enjoy every season. Know which season you're at. Kalau emang lagi santai-santai, kalau lagi ngoyo, ya udah go all out, right? Make the most out of that moment.
Well, I really like that advice. I think your advice is really powerful. There is the season, right? Maksudnya karena, ya, if we think about sustainable success, it's not about sprint all the time, right? Ada momen-momen di mana slow down because we play the long game. Yeah. And maybe final question for this section gitu ya. Kayak, I'm sure that working in Tokopedia is already taking a lot of your time. So meanwhile, you still interact with your followers on Instagram. Terus kayak lo juga recently open like a mentorship program. And I was just, wow. Wow. Like, tell us more, like, you know, what makes you still want to do that?
So I started, mungkin aku explain sedikit why I started blogging. Because the why matters. The why is where you will always get that energy. A year ago, mungkin I was speaking to my career coach and my career is doing well. Tapi a part of me have always had this hunger to help people. Aku sampai pernah mikir kayak, should I quit Tokopedia and just, you know, do a non-profit? But actually, that was not, after I clarified my thinking with my career coach, that was not what I was looking for. I still love my job. I still feel a lot of passion. I'm still growing in my job. Cuman aku butuh an outlet, you know, for my writing and for my sharing where I can give back to the community and be part of the community. Jadi my career coach just asked me, why don't you try doing something gitu? And that's when I started sharing, you know, little quotes here and there. Little lessons of nuggets here and there. Timingnya masih berantakan, cause capek banget ya di Tokopedia. After you do, mungkin kalau secara jam, oh kan bisa kak, ada aja 1 jam tiap hari. But trust me man, if you've done 9 hours back-to-back meeting with very short lunch breaks, after 6 or 7 p.m., even though it's still very early in the day, your mind is just so spent. You know, your body just can't, you can't think much much else gitu. Nah, but jadi I did the best that I could, mulai sharing gitu kan. And turns out, walaupun nggak punya agenda yang gimana-gimana gitu kan, I just want to blog and blog more. Pengen, sebenarnya intentionnya itu for me to build my writing stamina again, so that one day I can write a book gitu kan. Jadi warm up my writing muscles. Without me realizing, some of my writing really resonate with a lot of people. Dan people mulai nge-DM, like minta jadi mentorship lah, more public speaking engagement, starting, you know, all of these public engagement start to come, you know, invitations to share more, which was not at all in my plan, gitu. Now, how do I plan this around my schedule? In the beginning of the year, I think December, I burned myself out. So I started blogging at October. Tiba-tiba intense, dapat berbagai macam invitation juga on top of my own writing gitu kan. Toward December, I was saying yes to everything. I got burned out. Not only was I burned out, but when I do, you know, in a weekend, I could easily do 2 speaking engagements gitu kan, sharing at different universities. And I had very little time to recharge or to be with my husband. Jadi sekarang I think I manage myself better. I read a book, a great book about boundaries earlier this year, and I realized, oh, actually I still love doing this, but I need to manage better boundaries. So what I do today is I work on a monthly schedule with my coach where I determine the number of hours that I want to spend on different activities. So for example, in a month I make, you know, I have a number of meeting new, I have a number of hours that I spend on meeting new people or building my network. I have a set number of hours that I spend on mentoring that's already built into my schedule. So usually that's 2 to 3 hours per weekend that's dedicated to mentoring, whether it's one-on-one atau group atau or whatnot. And in a month, I limit public engagement to just 2 times in a month. That's it. I don't do more, which is significantly a lot less than what I was doing earlier in the year. Now I'm being a lot more mindful which engagements that I do, and I do these things a lot more happily, also much more present when I'm in these events because I'm fully recharged, and when I'm there, I'm fully ready to share and to help and to inspire.
Ooh, thanks Pris for explaining kayak ternyata why-nya mulai dari situ ya. And I think, yeah, you wanna continue again?
I think, you know, mungkin aku coba petik pelajarannya. Number one, if it's not your passion, you won't find the time or the energy to do it. Gitu.
Yes. Yeah.
Because for me, I have to mentor. I have to write. It's part of my calling. It's, you know, my background, as you heard earlier, is I was kind of under, I had an underprivileged situation. I was lucky enough to have many mentors who guided me through that process and overcome my obstacles. I want to be that mentor for others. It's actually equally important as my job at Tokopedia. Walaupun number of hours that I can commit is very different than the number of hours that I can commit to Tokopedia. But if you ask me, I cannot see myself stop writing or blogging. If anything, I want to do more of it, but trying to do it in a way that is still respectful of my own personal energy. I think jadi itu, satu, kalau itu bukan your passion or calling, you will never find it. But if something that you are really passionate about, even jam 10 malam, you know, you do something for like 10 to half an hour, 10 minutes, half an hour, you will find that energy and you will find that time. Mungkin my second advice for friends who are trying to pursue their passion here is don't aim for perfection. There is no perfect. There will be no perfect timing. There is no perfect writing. Yeah. You won't do something that everybody will always like, and everything will work out and whatnot. Just let go of the perfectionism and just do it. And when you do it for yourself. Don't do it to prove something to others. Don't do it because you want a certain outcome. You're just doing it for yourself. You know, I think that's really important.
Yeah. And the third thing, if I can add, based on what you shared ya, Pris ya. Menurut gue adalah ketika lo sadar bahwa, again, I think I need more time to do, you know, blogging and sharing, right? Menurut gue, banyak orang juga yang kayak langsung kayak, ah, let me just ditch my job and I do this full time, right? Tapi menurut gue, I think the careful assessment that you did with your career coach was very, very helpful. Karena kan sebenarnya I think, instead of seeing bahwa kayak quit or not quit, we see bahwa, okay, I have, you know, 7 30 kali 7 kali 24 jam, right? So, how can I organize my time to do
Benar.
things that energizes me, right? Dan menurut gue ketika ngeliatnya kayak gitu, kita jadi nggak terbatas untuk kayak startup atau you know, kerja atau resign or whatnot, karena ya udah ya dari waktu itu how do we wanna allocate on things that matter to us?
Ya, mungkin untuk teman-teman yang karena banyak banget ya sekarang mau konten creator, I'll tell you guys, to make money full time from content creation is not easy. Content creation is a competitive space. Most people don't want to pay for content. You know, I do a lot of my mentorship. They're free. They're not paid. I don't charge for many of these. And imagine if I had quit my job and try to be a mentor and I have to charge a lot of money just so that it can sustain me and my life. Kayak justru malah misinya aku untuk ngebantu underprivileged youth malah jadi nggak tercapai gitu kan Rio. Because the whole point of helping people who are less privileged is to make it accessible, to make it free. If I have to charge for it, then I can't help the people that I want to be helping. So that's why I need to, you know, be able to sustain myself. Thankfully at a job that I still have a lot of passion for. At the same time, at a job yang masih bisa banyak lesson ya dan learning for myself and also for others gitu.
And that encapsulates lesson yang tadi lo pelajarin dari HBS, right? Bahwa there is no one way, right? There are many ways, there are many combination, and this is the combination that you currently choose and work for you. Awesome.
And I think mungkin you know as we're about to close this chapter, I want to talk about that intention matters gitu.
Sure.
I had a mentee that recently approached me. Kak, I want to be like you. And I'm like, what do you mean by you want to be like me? Ya kak, aku mau do a lot of public speaking gitu kan. I want to do a lot of public speaking. Can you tell me how? And I'm like, okay. So what are the kind of content that you want to share? Well, I don't know kak. I just want to be invited. I'm like, okay, let's slow down here, right? Why do you need to be a public speaker? Dia bilang, because I want to get promoted. I want to get a better job. And I had to slow this person down. And I'm like, honey, if you want to get a better job, you can talk to a headhunter. You can be more active on LinkedIn and make yourself more discoverable on LinkedIn. You can do networking. That's how you can get a better job. But you don't have to do public speaking. Gitu loh. I know so many people who are amazing at what they do and they're not public figures. They don't have to do any sharing and whatnot. Jadi balik lagi ke intentionnya gitu kan. If what you're trying to do is to get promoted and get a better job, trust me, you don't need to be famous. There are people, you know, headhunters, recruiters, they can assess your skills, they can appreciate you even without you being active on Instagram and whatnot. Jadi balik lagi align ke intentionnya itu.
Wow. And what you just shared is a glimpse of question yang sering datang ke lo kan. So we'll talk more about that on the second part of this recording. Thanks Fris. Bye for now.
Awesome.
Thank you banget ya udah dengerin episode kita kali ini. Kalau lo suka sama konten ini dan merasa kalau lebih banyak orang perlu mendengarnya, please share this to your network. Karena itu akan membantu mereka untuk menemukan konten ini dan mentransformasi hidup mereka. Jangan lupa juga untuk follow kita di Instagram, karena setiap harinya kita akan post bite-size content untuk merefresh apa yang teman-teman sudah pelajari di podcast ini. Check out our Instagram at followyourflow.id. Terakhir, ada free course di website kita, yaitu tentang setting up your minimum viable priority, di mana lo bisa memahami prioritas hidup lo dan cara yang lebih konkret untuk mencapainya. Yuk, dapatkan akses di course-nya dengan check out our website di www.followyourflow.id.